the Dry Week, the quarterly challenge on the Whiskey Ball channel. This is something a little different. We're doing a reaction slash review of a song, a piece of music.
All right.
Now, I've never heard this piece of music, but I am aware this piece of music exists for one very specific reason. If you go to YouTube, and you go like incognito mode, so you don't have the algorithm playing with you, and then you type in whiskey, this song.
It's everywhere.
This song is the very, very first result for searching whiskey on YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
You know what the second result is? It's our video.
Ah, no!
So, if it wasn't for this song, and that's why I've refused to listen to it, because it's got like over, it's got a couple hundred million
yeah, of course it does.
Listens to just on YouTube. It's like, nope, screw those guys. They took the top spot. I want that top spot. I haven't listened to it yet, but for this show, I was like, okay. We're gonna do a little review of the music. And so I was thinking, oh, Daniel hasn't heard this. He's not a country music guy.
Ah.
And then he saw this. I was like, oh, I know that song. I know everything about the song. So it'll be a reaction from me, a review apparently from Daniel.
Actually, I do dig country music, but I dig real country music.
Right.
Not so pop
sure,
country.
I'm sure it's a very nuanced explanation that I'll suffer through momentarily. Right now, let's start off listening to the Chris Stapleton. Is that it? Stapleton. There's only a few hundred people in the world that know this song. Chris Stapleton,
Tennessee Whiskey.
Slow.
Oh. That is the kind of snare sound that producers dream of getting.
It's a
little reverby.
Okay. This is just a really
nice. And it's kind of sloppy black.
This is a dance, slow dance music.
And a tremolo guitar, clean.
Bluesy, man.
I know.
Bluesy.
This is why everybody loves Stapleton, because he's singing country music, but he's got a soul voice.
Okay.
So right?
I was thinking this is going to be like jinga, jinga, jinga. I'm countrying the tear in my beer and my dog in my pickup, which would have pissed me off.
No, this is old country, man.
You know when
this was written?
I'm digging this.
1981.
I'm looking at the picture here.
No, it's not 1881.
So,
1981, it was written by Linda Hargrove and like Dean Dill or something or other.
Okay.
And they wrote it, and it was recorded first by David Allan Coe. You know the song? I would hang around as long as you will let me. You know that one?
Oh, yeah.
Let me, never mind it standing in the, you don't have to call me darling.
Okay,
so that is who recorded this song first. For 2 years later, it was recorded by George Jones, the famous granddaddy of old country, George Jones. And that's who everyone thinks of this. They all think of this as a George Jones song. If you ask who
there's hundreds of millions of people that know this song through Chris Stapleton.
No, not through him. If you ask anybody who's ever heard Tennessee Whiskey before, who wrote Tennessee Whiskey, they will all say, oh, that's George Jones.
So Tennessee Whiskey is an old song.
Oh, yeah.
And the vibe I'm getting from completely clean slate, fresh perspective, this is slow dance, this is mellow groove, this is got a really bluesy type
of vibe. All of those people fought with saying Chris Stapleton's version is amazing.
Okay.
And they are not wrong.
Here we go.
Little rim shot. Ah, that voice. Man, Chris Stapleton.
Such a flutter up there.
Now listen to this. Oh, no, it's on the Cuba. There's a vocal in here at one point that he does such a magnificent gymnastic.
Let's get there.
All right, now we add in some more instruments.
Oh, yeah.
All right, right here. Little soul. Stretching. Now he goes for the stars.
Okay, so who do we have?
And harmony. That's his wife on harmony.
His wife is singing this with him.
Yeah.
Okay, because right now I'm predicting, I know from beginning to end what the vibe of this song is going to be. Mm-hmm. I've landed, there's not going to be any surprises. If I'm in this mindset, I'm in this mood, this is going to take me home.
And that's a long trail of chained vocal, right?
Yeah.
The first time I heard it, I thought, wow, that was risky. And he pulled it off. And then I thought it was a one-off. He does it every chorus, and he does it identical every chorus. Oh, and the perfect guitar solo. Ah, it's not here yet. I love this song.
Bottom of the bottles always.
Yeah, he's got rhythm in his vocals, like Van Morrison style. The rhythm of his
when
vocals.
You pulled out your heart, I didn't waste it.
Yeah. There's nothing. Oh, he goes R&B all of a sudden.
Okay. Okay. All right. That's where you just sit back. You have not necessarily Tennessee whiskey, but you need whiskey.
Oh yeah. You see why this is such a great
song? You're sitting in a big, comfy leather chair. Maybe a little fireplace going.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, what makes Stapleton great in the vocalist is not gymnastics. That's the kind of stuff you hear on American Idol.
Oh, I heard some gymnastics.
No, it's not just that.
Okay.
He's good at that.
Yeah.
Right? But what makes him really magnificent is he does something that some of my all-time favorite artists tend to do, like Randy Newman and Van Morrison and these guys, which is that their vocal rhythms are very rhythmic.
Yeah.
But they ignore the rhythm of the song. Like they're singing off on their own little tangent.
But they right? stick like you, the landing.
They'll always stick the landing.
Yeah.
And, well, no, I should say the rhythm always ties in,
okay.
But it's not repeating. Think of it like this.
Yeah.
You know the song Brown Eyed Girl. Everybody knows that song. You're my, right?
Yeah.
The problem with most people singing is, I can't remember the first line of that song. Brown. Let's do it. No, Tupelo Honey is another one from Van Morrison.
Yeah.
So, she's as sweet. Now, when people cover that, they sing, she's as sweet, rest as Tupelo Honey.
Yeah.
Rest. She's an angel of the first degree.
Don't play with it.
It's like,
they don't play with it. They're too rigid.
They just follow the rhythm, right?
Right.
Van Morrison sings it as, she's a sweet, and she's just like, Tupelo, honey, finally land it. And she's an angel of the first degree, totally all over the place.
Yeah.
If you listen to him on his verses,
mm-hmm.
he just sort of sings a rhythm that pops into his head around everybody else.
We've had this discussion before, and you have very different tastes in music than I do, but mm-hmm. our crossover bands, our crossover songs, are very often songs where the vocals are just really kind of out there, they barely have a relationship to the rhythm, but they don't break that relationship
right.
to the rhythm.
That's right.
And then whenever they bring it home, it's like they stick the landing.
Yeah, you're like, oh, that felt good.
Yeah. But they're just kind of all over the place, and it's like, wow, this is just, they're soaring.
Because notice where he brings it home?
Yeah.
It's the end of the chorus. And I drum on your love all the time. That's right in the pocket.
Yeah.
Right? So he only spreads. Now, I will tell you before we hit it, the guitar solo in here is a piece of art. Because most people play guitar solos to show how much they can do.
Yeah.
But a good guitar soloist leaves air and room to breathe and only hits the melodic notes and the rhythms that make you go, And this is closer to B.B. King.
So he has the technical precision, but he's not trying to show off and prove a point.
Yeah, he leaves a lot of space, and he's a soloist.
Okay.
He's not just hiring guns doing this. It's him. And his wife's voice is great with his. Here's that same vocal gymnastic, note for note. That's American Idol shit right there. Now he brings it home, like you said, right here. Right on the beat. Makes you feel better about it. Nah, this solo. Space.
Yeah.
All melody.
Because
melody.
If there would have been more notes than that.
Yeah, if he was showing off.
Then you wouldn't have had. It would have been a break in the vibe, in the flow, in the mood of this entire song.
Yeah. Whoever's playing this is sitting down and leaning backwards.
Yeah. Because
they're not like foot on the monitor and head banging.
That could have gotten way too busy very quickly.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Oh, see, this is B.B. King territory. A little harmony hammer-ons. Oh, yeah. and then leads into the finish. That's a good guitar solo in my mind. A good guitar solo in my mind, by the time it ends, it leads its way and as a handoff to the vocalist.
Yeah.
Right? So it's like finishing, 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 it's yours now. Mm-hmm. As opposed to, wham, I'm done. Okay.
Now it's your turn. Turn to
yeah.
Pick up the pieces and keep going.
Yeah.
He tosses it around every time.
Every time. And it's the same. If you look at him, you can put him in front of each other. He hits all the same notes. That's precision, my friend. That's on purpose. Oh, yeah.
Is this the big finish?
If you can call it a big finish.
Keeps it chill.
Notice that the drummer always sort of leads into like, it's going to be bigger, it's going to be bigger. No, it's good. It's
you know, good. It does. It starts building up. And then just sends you coasting.
Yeah, I love it. Now, can you imagine how much money Linda Hargrove has made off of this song? Now, because the thing is, this is one of the top-selling songs on digital downloads of all of his stuff.
Okay.
It's viewed, it's on, it's most played on the radio
he
from
said
his
it's
album.
From the 70s.
It's, there's like two or three. It's from 81.
Mm-hmm.
And now, back in that time and still today, a lot of songwriters would write for a label, so they didn't own the song.
Yeah.
Right? They would write it, the label owned it.
Okay.
And then the label would have artists sing it.
Yeah.
And then there was an era where then you would write songs for a label, but you still owned all the rights to it.
Yeah.
Right? And they would license it from you or something like that.
Sure.
Now, if she got licensing, then George Jones, when he made it a number one hit, and David Allan Coe, when his went up into the top 100,
yeah.
And Stapleton's,
what is it?
All of that is royalties okay. to Linda Hargrove's
so,
family.
Tennessee Whiskey, this song, mm-hmm. it's been around for decades. What is it about this song? Because it's seemingly simple. There's not like ridiculous, you know, vocals, instrumentation. It doesn't get complicated. It's simple. You get this vibe, and it carries you from beginning to end. There isn't any big surprises in there. But this
musically,
song,
there's a lot of songs
again and
like
again
that.
And again has become a huge hit.
Well, musically, there's a lot of songs with that open kind of nice thing, right?
Yeah.
The picture you get in your head, sipping whiskey.
Yeah.
That's a perfect country combo in the groove, right?
Yeah.
And then the phonetic, this would not have worked if he had said anything other than Tennessee Whiskey.
Tennessee
the Whiskey. The sheer phonetic.
The singability.
Of you're as smooth.
Boom, boom. As Kentucky bourbon.
Yeah, doesn't work. As a single malt scotch.
Yeah, Kentucky.
Right? No.
It'd be the hard K in there.
No, nothing.
It's
got to be as Tennessee Whiskey.
Yeah.
It's the right words.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just the right words. All right, bring us home, Stapleton. Hear that acoustic guitar in the background?
Yeah.
It only creeps above in the mix on the turnarounds. Like right now, it's kind of background.
And then they swell it up.
And he changes the rhythm when they swell him up above the rest of the band.
Yeah.
And you hear his acoustic go, ding, gang, gang, ding, gang. And he basically is doing a drum roll.
And then it just fades off into the sunset.
Bam. He's basically doing like a little drum roll with his acoustic guitar.
Yeah.
Leading into a turnaround.
So, okay.
Are you a convert?
The song deserves to be in the top spot when you search for whiskey on YouTube.
Yeah.
We will be satisfied.
I may or may not have played this song hundreds of times while drinking whiskey.
Really?
Okay. George Jones and Stapleton's version. Regularly in my house, this album gets played.
Mm-hmm.
My wife loves this album too. And when this song comes on, my first thought is, I really need to get some Tennessee whiskey just so that whenever the song comes on, it's like, well, you know what time it is.
Yeah. All right, guys, I hope you enjoyed this music review / reaction.
All right, tomorrow we have the last dry episode ending in a Patreon.
On the Whiskey Tribe channel.
On the Whiskey Tribe channel.
And then we're going to do a drink stream with the patrons. And then we'll be back to glorious
Finally.
And magnificent whiskey.
Is there any kind of challenge left to do?
Man.
What do you do with that?
You know what?
I think I met the challenge by knowing the whole history of the song.
Fine. That was just such a good song. Challenge completed.
Challenge completed.
The trial is done.
Yes! It finally pays off to have Rex got put in charge of it.
All right, guys, here's to fighting, stealing, drinking.
If you fight, may you fight for a friend.
If you steal, may you steal a lover's heart.
And if you drink, may you drink with us.
Yes. As the Tennessee Whiskey. Well done, Whittington. You've passed the trials. And Mooch was there too. Tomorrow, we attack the vault.